Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Colonoscopy Clinical Care Standard webinar. Everything you need to know about the standard. My name's Iain Skinner. I'm a colorectal surgeon in Melbourne. I was the co-chair of the Clinical Care Standard Working Group who developed this standard with Anne Duggan, who was my co-chair. I also sit on the Conjoint Committee for the Recognition of Training in Endoscopy and the GESA Recertification Committee. And I'm a member of the Royal Australasian College of Surgeons Surgical Gastrointestinal Endoscopy Committee. And for many years now, I've been involved in writing opinions and being involved in the development of quality in endoscopy. Before we start the webinar tonight, I would like to acknowledge the traditional owners of all the lands in which we are meeting tonight and pay my and our respects to their elders, past, present, and emerging. So the standard, why have we got it? What is it? When do we use it? And how do we use it? This webinar has been put together to give you, as practicing endoscopists, a view of what we were trying to develop in putting the standard together and how you can utilise it for the highest quality endoscopy that can be provided in the centres in which you work. So why have a standard? We know that colonoscopy throughout Australia is not provided in an equal fashion. In areas of Australia, 4,000 colonoscopies per 100,000 population are undertaken per year. In other areas, 100 colonoscopies per 100,000 are undertaken every year. We know that this represents an element of almost 30 times difference in different areas. In around 2013-2014, almost 600,000 colonoscopies were undertaken. It's predicted that because of the national bowel screen, we will be looking in 2021 at almost 1.1 million colonoscopies being undertaken in Australia. The government had concerns that the national bowel screen was going to stress the system and really wanted us to have high quality colonoscopy. And in 2016, led a move to develop a safety and quality model for colonoscopy. This was undertaken in conjunction with members of GESA and RACS in order to try and look at how we would best provide colonoscopy for all Australians in the highest quality way and the most equitable way. One of the elements of this model was the development of a clinical care standard to be utilised with the NSQHS standards against which all of our procedural centres were to be assessed. We know that we already have recognition of training, and that was part of the model. We knew that recertification of practice quality and audit of how we are doing as an individual colonoscopist, which is run currently by GESA, was required. And the Colonoscopy Clinical Care Standard was developed to promote equivalence of high quality colonoscopy in all centres which provide colonoscopy in Australia. There was a development team brought together by the ACSQHC, the Commission of Safety and Quality in Healthcare. Clinical groups, consumer groups, and provider groups from the private hospital and public hospital sectors participated in the development process. Each of the quality statements was to focus on factors to achieve the highest quality in colonoscopy. The standard was released in 2018 as the first accessible clinical care standard as part of the national standards. So what does the standard look like? Released in 2018, it is part of the national health standards, and it needs to be implemented in all public and private hospitals and all day procedure centres nationally. Is part of the clinical governance standard and advisories have been released to all centres to look at how this should be applied and where this applies. The standard has several different goals. It is to inform patients about their care, to guide health professionals to deliver that care, and to help systems identify what is needed to support and monitor care. So what we want is high quality care. It generally comprises a small number of agreed quality statements that describe that care, and it helps services review their performance and allow equivalence throughout all centres which undertake the same type of care. There are 9 different quality statements which take us from the initial assessment and referral for colonoscopy all the way through to the discharge from the endoscopy suite and how we report and follow up the patients who've had colonoscopies. There must be adequate information given at the start, appropriate evidence and guidelines used to decide when and how the patient has their colonoscopy. There needs to be information around consent and information around how to prepare the bowel. There is already documentation from the College of Anaesthetists about sedation. The clinicians have certification and recertification as part of their statement. The procedure itself should be the highest quality in terms of the colonoscopy itself and the documentation. The discharge should be undertaken when it's safe to do so with adequate information given, and the communication of results and an evidence basis for the follow-up of the patient should be communicated to the patient's normal doctor. Along with the standard, there are 4 indicators by which centres can monitor their local performance. The first is bowel preparation, looking at how good the bowel preparation is across the board with all patients. The second is cecal intubation to ensure that the entire colon has been examined in as many patients as possible. And we all know this is part of the recertification process. Adenoma detection rate, so the proportion of patients who had a colonoscopy that detected one or more of the traditional adenomas, and the newer indicator, that of sessile serrated polyp detection rate, the proportion of patients who had one or more serrated adenomas or sessile serrated polyps detected in the proximal colon, which can include, as per the recertification guidelines, hyperplastic polyps proximal to the sigmoid colon, so in ascending, transverse, descending, or cecum. So let's go through the quality statements in a little bit more detail. In the initial assessment and referral statement, we look at when a patient is being referred for colonoscopy, that the documentation is adequate to provide enough information so that clinicians can assess the appropriateness, the risk, and the urgency of consultation and provision of the scope. The patient needs to be allocated an appointment with their clinical needs, and that for us is mostly fairly easy once we've seen the patient. But there are some issues around centres which undertake open access work. And with this open access work, some amount of subjective assessment of the patient's urgency needs to be undertaken. So it's very important that appropriate information is sent by the GP. There are some implementation resources for this, and there is certainly a referral form which has been produced by the clinician, which can be utilised by any GP that has this form. It's been developed in consultation and it's embedded in at least 5 of the major software systems. And so this can be filled electronically and forwarded to either colonoscopist or to the centre providing open access colonoscopy. This is how some of the templates look in Genie and Communicare. There is also a booklet from the Cancer Institute of New South Wales and New South Wales Health looking at how to undertake direct access colonoscopy. This provides a model for removal of the initial specialist consultation so that there is a more rapid access and a reduction in the need to undergo a consultation to have that as a barrier to colonoscopy. Nurse-led telephone triage assessments have been shown to be less costly for the patient and allow specialist time to be utilised for more complex patients. And this model of care has been developed by the Cancer Institute and supports the clinical care standard. I believe this is available online through New South Wales Health. Appropriate and timely colonoscopy. Patients need to be offered their colonoscopy when it's appropriate, whether it be for screening, surveillance, investigation. And there are certainly significant national evidence-based guidelines as to when the colonoscopy should occur. And for example, in Victoria, there are state-based guidelines for the categorisation of urgency of symptomatic investigation colonoscopy. Decisions about colonoscopy also need to be made in context of the patient's ability to take PrEP and the benefit they are going to accrue from their colonoscopy. And if it's not appropriate, then the clinician should advise the patient and their referring doctor of recommended alternate management strategies. Some of the implementation resources are contained within the Cancer Council's literature on the Clinical Guidelines Network and Cancer Wiki. And both the clinical practice guidelines for the prevention and early detection of the management and the management of colorectal cancer and the clinical practice guidelines for surveillance colonoscopy provide evidence for when and how surveillance colonoscopy should be utilised. Informed decision-making and consent. Again, not too difficult if we're doing this in our rooms, but a lot more difficult with the open and direct access systems. So the standard suggests to us that a high-quality endoscopic facility will ensure that patients get comprehensive and appropriate information about PrEP, colonoscopy, sedation, prior to starting their bowel PrEP, that they've had an opportunity to discuss the reason for colonoscopy, risks, benefits, costs, alternatives before deciding to proceed, and that their understanding is assessed and the information provided and their consent to sedation, colonoscopy, and therapeutic intervention is documented. Now we see here on the graphic someone signing, but as we all know, informed consent is not necessarily a signature on a piece of paper. Informed consent is ascertaining that the patient understands what's going on. And that consent does not necessarily have to be provided by a consultant endoscopist, but certainly the systems of direct access and some of the video resources which are available online that are utilised by other hospitals are very adequate in ensuring that adequate information is presented to the patients before they take their bowel PrEP, even if they formally sign a form to say that they understand this on the day. The Commission has provided an informed consent fact sheet so that we can see how best to undertake this part of the standard and how it should be documented within the patient's record. Bowel PrEP, one of those things that I'm sure you all, like I, struggle with at times. But once you find a good PrEP and a good set of instructions, which seem to work for your patients when provided to them and explained to them appropriately, we should stick to it. It's important that the patient receives an appropriate bowel PrEP for their particular needs, their comorbidities, their medications, and their previous responses. We know how important good bowel PrEP is for a high-quality colonoscopy, and it needs to be discussed at length with the patient either by yourself as the endoscopist or by a practice nurse who is experienced and able to counsel in this area. Consumer-appropriate instructions, usually written instructions, are very important so that patients don't forget how to take their bowel PrEP and it's done in the highest possible way. One of the implementation resources present on the Commission's website is the Having a Colonoscopy video, which talks about many of the issues that we've dealt with in the first four sections of the standard. Sedation, is usually given for most patients who are having colonoscopy. It's important that prior to colonoscopy, the patient's assessed appropriately by an appropriately trained clinician who identifies their risks. Sedation should be planned according to the patient's risk. This should be discussed with the patient and given in accordance with the guidelines of the ANZ College of Anaesthetists. Now we come to us, the clinicians. So who are we? What should we be? Well, the colonoscopy needs to be performed by someone who has some credentials, whose training is recognised, who's working within their scope of clinical practice, and has been certified as having appropriate training, and is currently undergoing a recertification process, as provided at the moment by GESA. The same should apply to those giving sedation or anaesthesia, and to all of the clinical support team, both in the endoscopy suite and in the recovery room of the endoscopy suite, all should be credentialed clinicians working within a scope of clinical practice. And no doubt this area of the actual standard will generate some discussion later. But if we look at the implementation resources, there is some information about what's expected in terms of certification and recertification of colonoscopy in practicing endoscopists. Many of you will be absolutely familiar with the GESA recertification website entry portal. It's here that we upload our 150 consecutive endoscopies in a single group or three groups of 50, where we are able to put in the pathology, and then this is assessed by our group, the recertification committee, and we're able to then provide some measure of the self-reported quality of colonoscopy by individuals. This process is being supported by several of the software providers. Those of you who have EndoBase, there is a module on EndoBase which can be placed, where all of the data can be actually transmitted directly to the recertification database, given your credentials. And this will become more available as Synapse and several of the other, Provation, and several of the other software providers are actually able to upload this onto their systems. We come now to the procedure. So the procedure statement says that when a patient's undergoing colonoscopy, the entire colon, including the cecum, is examined carefully and systematically. That doesn't mean stopping the ascending colon and taking a picture of the valve. It does mean getting into the cecum, visualizing the appendix and the triradiate fold and getting a photo of that, and trying to retroflex or look to the side and ensure that that area behind the ileocecal valve is fully seen and well documented, either by photos or your vision. Entering the ileocecal valve and into the ileum is not mandated by the standard, but I have a strong belief that trying to get ileal intubation at every colonoscopy allows for good practice and the ability, when necessary, to enter the ileum to undertake further investigation and biopsies. The adequacy of the bowel prep, all of the findings, biopsies, any polyps removed, and any other interventions and adverse events should be documented as part of this process. And all polyps should be removed and submitted for histological examination. There are still people who thermally ablate or drop polyps, and while this has been mooted as one of the ways in which to deal with polyps in the colon, I think we've all now come to the conclusion that it's best for the patient, and certainly to understand their risk, to ensure that we know what each polyp is once it's been removed. There's also been some questions asked about the quality of equipment, and we know that there is a significant difference in equipment standard throughout different centres. The standard has not gone as far as to mandate what equipment you must have or how it should report, but I think it's clear to most people that having as close to the most up-to-date equipment and the best software packages will enhance your ability to see, given the improvement in cameras, and the ability to document given the improvement in software packages. The next statement relates to discharge. But after recovery and before discharge, the patient should be advised, both verbally and in writing, about what's been found in their colonoscopy, what's been done, what's happened, and when they can resume activities, normal medications, and how they should be followed up. There is an implementation resource for this, which is a very simple checklist. And the patient needs to be discharged into the care of a responsible adult at a time when it's safe for them to be such discharged. Statement 9 relates to reporting and follow-up, and this is a little more confusing and difficult. It says that the colonoscopist should communicate the reason for the colonoscopy, the findings, the histology results, and recommendations to the general practitioner and other relevant clinicians of the patient and the patient, and is documented in the facility records. There is sometimes, of course, a disconnect between undergoing the colonoscopy and receiving histology. And so sometimes, by need, these things may be different in terms of there may be a letter to go out to the GP, but the histology may follow at a different time. Recommendations for surveillance should be consistent with national evidence-based guidelines. And again, this may be able to be done on the initial report, which is sent out, may be done on a letter if the clinician providing the colonoscopy is the clinician who reviews the patient, or may be communicated by the centre undertaking the colonoscopy once information about the results of colonoscopy are more clearly available, such as histology, numbers of polyps, etc. If more immediate treatment or follow-up is needed, then arrangements should be made by the colonoscopist, but usually in liaison with the patient's general practitioner. Again, the Commission has provided some resources for this, both a standardised colonoscopy report, the basics of which are followed in most of the software packages, and a basic follow-up letter, which allows the endoscopist to provide the GP with a fairly standardised summary of what happened at the scope and what should happen subsequently. When we look at these reports within the Olympus database, Endobase, and Provation, we can see that all of these things are contained within the report, including graphics. And I can't emphasise how important graphics are to allow for both documentation of the procedure and also the ability of the recertification committee to assess extent of colonoscopy and, to an extent, quality of colonoscopy based on what the inside of the colon looks like in terms of the bowel prep and the extent that the colon is intubated, whether to the cecum or the ileum, and what's seen, what major polyps and what major interventions have been undertaken. So for all of you, try and get as many pictures into your reports as you can. Certainly in Provation, you can put as many as you want. In Endobase, you're generally limited to about 12, but can be printed out separately if need be. So when do we need to have the Colonoscopy Clinical Care Standard in place by? Well, essentially now. It became accessible in January of 2019. And from then, it was expected that all facilities should be able to demonstrate that they were working towards implementing all of the statements of the standard relative to them. Therefore, there may be some things which did not apply directly to the centre or the endoscopist or the anaesthetist, but there had to be some oversight from the endoscopy facility to ensure that this was being undertaken. And this is how the assessors will look at each facility. So how is the standard to be implemented and how is it to be assessed? We have had a pilot and four different sites throughout Australia were utilised from May to August of 2019. And simulated accreditation was undertaken against the NSQHS standards to look at the feasibility. There were some issues and the pilot findings came across with quite a lot of useful statements. Generally, there was a very broad support from the stakeholders and the pilot sites regarding implementation. Most sites were already in many ways addressing most of the statements present in the standard. There were some key areas that were felt generally that needed to be addressed. Better referrals, especially in the open access arena. The ensuring of appropriate and timely colonoscopies based on indications. The way informed consent was given and taken. How bowel prep was administered and the results of that bowel prep. And how the colonoscopy was reported. The Commission has developed enhanced resources in all of these areas and is continuing to engage all the stakeholders that have previously helped them and any others that want to be involved in developing further resources. It's working to ensure that GPs are aware of the templates that can be utilised, procedurists are aware of their responsibilities, and that the reporting and the advice provided to patients is appropriate. More resources still need to be developed, and the Commission is working to do this and has a communication strategy which will promote the colonoscopy clinical care standard. Many resources are present on the safetyandquality.gov.au website, which include fact sheets, posters, videos, information on informed consent, certification and recertification, implementation, an interview with Professor Anne Duggan, who was my co-chair on the colonoscopy topic working group, and both Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander resources, which are currently in development, although the group working with Tony Rahman, that many of you may know in Queensland, has also developed resources that may well be incorporated onto the site at a later stage. Looking through some of these resources, you will see clinician and consumer facts sheets and the standard in summary, along with the interview with Professor Anne Duggan. We know and have seen the referral templates, the colonoscopy reports, the GP follow-up letters, and these are all available on the Commission's website at www.safetyandquality.gov.au. I hope this brief tour of the colonoscopy clinical care standard has been useful for you. I've tried to highlight some of the points that we've put into this standard, which will help you to improve the output of colonoscopy from your centres and the quality of colonoscopy broadly across the country. We are now going to have a short question and answer session that we will try and address any queries you have, and no doubt there will be some questions about recertification, there'll be some questions about consent and bowel prep. And we will try and answer those as fully as we can. If that's not totally possible, we will communicate those back to you once we have the answers. So at this point in time, I'm going to close the presentation, ask for questions, and I'd like to thank the Commission for inviting me to be part of this presentation tonight. And I hope that you all will have found it useful and will take away some of the messages from this.
Thanks, Iain. If I can just get the others to turn on their cameras, please. And microphones would be good for answering questions. We do have a few questions. The first one, hello and thank you. Regarding open access endoscopy, are figures available for the proportion of referrals for endoscopy that are refused by the clinician? I suspect it is very low indeed.
I don't have an answer for exactly how many are accepted or referred. I must say that the majority of my personal practice is not open access, and if open access is requested, that open access is directed to my room so that I can make an assessment directly myself of whether I think a colonoscopy should be done. And if there's any question personally, I will speak to the patient about the issues and the recommendations. And in terms of this, there are a small percentage of people who certainly do not need a colonoscopy, and I personally reject. However, for someone to come to a facility fully prepped, it is very difficult to say, no, you don't need a colonoscopy. And this, I think, is why it's so important that resources, such as the resources that Tony Rahman has been involved in developing in Queensland, such as the resources which will come through the Commission's website, such as those used by each facility to ensure that patients are informed of what their scope is going to be, and that the assessment of each patient is done by an appropriate clinician, whether that be medical or nursing, I don't think it matters, as long as guidelines are clear and each facility has those guidelines. And they're going to have to demonstrate that. Part of the assessment is to demonstrate that this is being done appropriately. And so referrals may well be looked at, and some of the referral letters for open access may well be looked at in order to assess whether appropriate provision of colonoscopy has been undertaken, whether it's undertaken when it shouldn't be, or it's delayed when it shouldn't be. So both of these things may be an issue, certainly within the open access system. Is there anything further that I can address there? Anne, would you like to make a comment at all?
No, I think you've answered it, Ian. Might go on to another question. I'm happy.
Thank you. So for the public system, will there be a recommendation that local health districts install appropriate endoscopy-specific software to ensure standards are easy to upload to GISA, but also ensure all patients and GPs receive an adequate endoscopy report?
I think that in many ways is implicit within the standard. It's not explicitly stated that a single system or a particular system should be utilised, but the Commission has provided a template which should be utilised for every report, and that is contained in all of the software packages. And if it's not in a software package which you have, or you do not have a software package, I think there is enough in the standard for you to go to whoever is running your endoscopy facility or whoever is running your local health district to say, this is what the Commission has suggested in the Colonoscopy Clinical Care Standard. We need to be able to provide an appropriate report, and our responsibility as a healthcare system is to have the appropriate software or reporting capability to do this. Again, we haven't said that we need to embed photos into every report, but this, of course, provides the highest possible quality. And in assessing the reports, an assessor looking at your facility may well say, well, you're sort of getting it, but this is an area you need to work on. So if you don't have one, it may well be that the assessors say that the reports provided do not meet the standard of the Commission or the Colonoscopy Care Standard, and therefore you may need to invest in a system. We haven't mandated a system. We haven't mandated that it has to be a software system, but I think that it is implied that this would be best practice.
I think anecdotally also, just by putting the clinical care standard out there, the endoscopy system guys have been saying that there's been an uptake in buying and purchasing electronic reporting system, endoscopy reporting system. So that's a good thing, rather than old handwritten reports.
Absolutely. And certainly what I said earlier about endoscopy systems, we can't mandate you have to have one system or another, or that it has to be the most up to date. But if you have a patently inadequate system that doesn't take pictures, that is still completely eyepiece driven rather than video driven, that it's not a high definition system, I think there's enough in the standard for you to be going to your provider and saying, look, we're not meeting the needs of a high quality colonoscopy in 2021. We need to look at how we're doing this, and we need to look at what the assessors are going to say when they come and talk to us about what we're actually providing. So again, it's not explicit in the standard, but I think there's enough there for a very reasonable commencement of conversation about all of these issues with your provider, whoever runs your endoscopy suite, whether that be public or private, to ensure that the highest quality colonoscopy we want is supported by the highest possible quality of instrumentation and reporting software that can be put into that particular suite. We might move on.
Vaughan, you're muted.
Sorry. I just add to that, on top of what Ian and Anne have said, We've worked closely in the last year or so with Provation and Endobase, and as Anne pointed out, there has been more of an uptake using the systems because of the standard they feel, but also they know that their system needs to support this standard, so that we've been working closely with them to try and help with the capturing of the indicators as well. So they're very aware of the standard and what their system needs to be able to do to support clinicians using it.
Thank you. Okay, plenty more questions. The next one, where can I download a good bowel preparation protocol and patient information and consent forms for colonoscopy?
I can't give you a site off the top of my head, but the Commission does have resources as part of the informed consent. In terms of my personal consent and my personal use of bowel prep, I have developed this over time, and we have this as part of my practice, and without wanting to make a rod for my practice's back, I would be happy if anyone wanted to hear what our particular protocols are to send those across to any individual. I use one specific bowel prep the majority of the time, and I have a set of instructions that has let me personally, with my practice nurse, let me emphasise this, with my practice nurse spending a lot of time with the individual patients to ensure that it's well understood what has to be done in terms of the bowel prep, I would now have at least a half of my bowel preps that I would generally rate as excellent with no residue whatsoever and no liquid in the colon, and about a quarter as very good, and the rest as anywhere from good to poor. So I must say that I think my bowel preps have improved significantly with the standardisation. My recommendations are based very much on the company recommendations for this particular bowel prep. I won't say a name over the actual webinar, but I found it to be very good, reasonably well tolerated, as well as anything else, if not slightly better. And I'm on the internet. My practice is in Werribee in Victoria. So if you wanted to send an email to my practice email, which should be, again, found on the internet or to me, I'd be more than happy to send a copy of those through.
I think also Gregor Brown and colleagues did a good chapter in the NHMRC guidelines on bowel prep for colonoscopy surveillance from memory. So the
guidelines. So up on the Cancer Council wiki site and the surveillance guidelines and the early detection guidelines. So I may well be present there. I haven't read those specifically, but Gregor's a pretty incredible endoscopist and gets very good results. So I think it's probably worthwhile looking at those. I don't know if you're out there, Gregor, but if you are.
Okay, the next one. To re-credential colonoscopy, does average bowel preparation considered an adequate examination by the recertification committee? Endo-based reporting system only has options excellent, good, average or poor bowel preparation. The Boston bowel preparation scale is not available on Endo-base.
So it's always a bit of a vexed question. In terms of the recertification committee, we look at everyone's submission, and we know that if we see someone who writes good, 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 et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, that's probably not correct. And when we see good and look at a photo showing a cecum full of feces, we know that's not correct. We don't expect every bowel prep to be excellent. We do know that in recertification, what the bowel prep actually is doesn't necessarily, other than perhaps obscuring some of the polyps, change whether you're recertified or not. What you do with it in your private practice when you have an average or a poor bowel prep is how good your practice is in terms of treating patients. And if you have a poor bowel prep, then you do need to go back either early or to revisit that, pull out early, don't complete, charge a flexible sigmoidoscopy and come back at a later stage and repeat the colonoscopy if you don't feel this is going to be an adequate examination. And so, in fact, in many ways, you may find that if you do that, you don't count the flexible signal endoscopies in recertification, that many of your power preps will be good because you'll have pulled out before you complete those that are very poor or completely inadequate. However, it's not up to us to determine your colonoscopy based on whether you have a good or poor bowel prep. The recertification looks at your polyp detection rate, and that of course relates to your bowel prep, but it's not the bowel prep we're looking at. We're looking at adenoma detection rates, sesosillarated polyp detection rates proximal to the sigmoid, and significant polyp detection rates, as well as cecal intubation, to an extent ileal intubation, and the types of colonoscopy patients that you're doing. So PrEP won't stop you from being recertified. However, if you're reporting PrEP is good and it's obviously poor, we may question the veracity of other things within your submission. I'm not sure if that answers the question completely, but would you comment otherwise, Anne?
No, I think you answered the question.
Thank you. That person has a second part to their question. Will a recertification committee accept a colonoscopy with good bowel preparation of a patient that only has a partial colon, for example, post-right hemicolectomy?
Absolutely. But you cannot use that patient at the moment as part of your adenoma, sesosserrated or significant polyp detection rate calculation. But any colonoscopy is countable. So they become a patient who has an incomplete colon, and it's reflected as such. I'm a colorectal surgeon. Many of my patients have incomplete colons. I can only count so many of my patients in my colonoscopy clinical sort of recertification submission. So it doesn't matter whether the patient has had a colectomy or not. You just have to document that there's an incomplete colon and that patient is not used in calculation of all of your rates.
Thank you. Just some information being provided by an attendee that a website, bowelprep.net, is a good website being prepared by John Ding from the Young GISA, just in regard to that previous question about a bowel prep protocol.
And I apologise, John. I had neglected to mention your bowel prep site, and certainly this is something which had been presented last year at AGW in Adelaide. And has some fantastic bowel prep instructions. I think John's system that he's been able to develop actually has notifications that will come out and is applicable to many different bowel preps. And so whatever prep you have can be fed into that system and your patient gets reminders as to when to take prep and how to take that prep. So again, a very useful system to look at and investigate if you are actually wanting something to provide your patients with.
I popped it in the chat to everybody. Yeah.
That's a good idea now.
Thanks. Okay, thank you. Next question. Why was photo documentation of the cecum and or ileum not included in the procedure recommendations sections of the standard?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. We did debate that as part of the standard. And all of my memory doesn't necessarily take me back to everything we said, but I think that there were some issues, that there were some systems still in certain areas that could not meet that. And while it was recommended that this would be an entirely appropriate way to ensure that the cecum had been intubated, that there were some people who were unable to provide that documentation, so it was unfair to put it into the standard. That's part of my vague memory. Yeah. Anne, do you remember?
You're absolutely right. You've got to make the standard. You want the goal, but you don't want to actually make it impossible for people to meet the specifics because you've written something.
Now, the difficulty there would have been that, yes, perhaps that would have meant that certain centres would have had to invest in these things. But if that was not, for whatever reason, an economic or physical reality, that they couldn't invest in a system that was able to photo document, then we were, you know, perhaps even withdrawing certain centres from being able to perform colonoscopy. And that would be an incredibly negative outcome. Most places will have a printer and be able to take some photos that can be appended to a written or typed or computer report. But again, it was felt that this was just one step too far. In the future, this may become, and certainly we'll look at the assessor's reports, no doubt, when the standard is reassessed in a couple of years and re-debate this topic, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Okay. Why not some mention of using cold snare rather than hot biopsy or hot snare in the standard?
Again, something that we mooted, and what we had to do was provide what was reasonably simple instructions. We're not there as a standard to provide education in terms of your basic training as an endoscopist. And part of this is basic training as an endoscopist, the move to cold snaring and the move away from hot biopsy forceps, which have a significantly documented increased rate of perforation, and even hot snaring, which has, again, a rate of perforation, but also a documented greater rate of bleeding than cold snaring, which takes a mucosa off over the submucosa rather than cutting through it. So that is part of the education process where we as colonoscopists should be trained in this. And if we train prior to this information, part of our responsibility as clinicians is to keep up to date with the new advances and the best practice in our areas of practice. And so attending NETI courses and being part of the education system in colonoscopy is vitally important. And this is part of the recertification issue. A lot of people say, why should I recertify? Why should I be part of this? Well, it's an audit. Don't we all audit our practices? Don't we all look at the quality we're providing? Don't we all want to know what quality we are providing and how it compares against other people? I certainly know at the surgical audits, those people who are having troubles are often taken under the wings and either supported or retrained in terms of certain procedures. We know the vascular audit in the College of Surgeons and the National Vascular Audit provides both an assessment of quality, but also a support system. Now, recertification hasn't yet done that, but it's implicit that over time we will need to develop those systems, both through GESA and the College of Surgeons. And I think that these are areas that will come, and there are certainly significant discussions going on in both camps about how we support those people who are not yet at what we believe is the most modern level of practice. Now, the National Endoscopy Training Initiative, NETI, which you can find on the GESA website, has courses which will teach all of these things. And so I think that it's important that we as endoscopists engage in CME with our endoscopy, not just our gastroenterology or our surgical, putting our hands inside someone work, that we actually look at endoscopy in the same way we look at everything else and keep as up to date as we possibly can with the best techniques. So the standard is there to say what the patient should expect in terms of basic care, high quality colonoscopy and modern practice, but to try and get to the minutiae of everything you do or don't do, should we actually say that you must do a withdrawal protocol, everyone must J in the cecum and the rectum, everyone must double pass the hepatic flexure, the splenic flexure, the mid-transverse loop, the sigmoid colon? What level do we go to? How long does each quality statement have to be? Could be a textbook, but our CME and our ability to go out and relearn and to update ourselves is where we should be getting this information from.
Okay, thank you. A long question. For recertification, until endoscopy reporting software directly uploads data into the recertification database, can endoscopists upload a report from their institution which details their metrics, cecal intubation, ADR, SSADR? Our institution is looking at providing endoscopists with a summary of their colonoscopy statistics and histology, histologically proven ADR and SSADR, but are unsure if this will be acceptable evidence or if individuals' cases must still be lodged. Logged.
For a long question, I'll give you a short answer. I don't know. And that question should be directed to the Recertification Committee Care of GESA. Mark Scheinman is our chairman, and that will no doubt be a question which we could address. However, trying to standardise everything, we would, I suppose, initially expect everyone to upload every case, but I can't tell you what we would say to that suggestion. But again, directed to GESA, directed to Mark Scheinman, the chair of the Recertification Committee. Mark, if you're out there, sorry, rod for your back, mate.
Thank you. We'll make sure that gets passed on. Has it occurred that those working in public hospitals might have a better ADR compared to those working in the private system? Is there an inherent bias towards colonoscopists who work in public hospitals?
I'm not sure what's meant by that. I think that when you look at public and private practice, if you're comparing apples with apples, then it shouldn't matter. When I look at my ADR in my public practice and my private practice, they're very similar because I'm scoping very similar patients. They're male or female, they're over the age of 50, they have an intact colon, and they may be de novo or they may be in a screening program for a specific reason. And that's true for both my private and my public practice. And I do probably a third of my colonoscopies in public and about two thirds in private at the moment. So I haven't seen a particular difference in my practice. So I would say that I think the importance in terms of how you colonoscope is how you colonoscope. And that will guide how good your ADR is and your sessile detection rate is and your significant polyp detection rate is. The diligence, care, identifying polyps, whether you're in public or private, is what's needed for you to be a good endoscopist who's identifying plenty of polyps.
I suppose my only comment would be that if you think about the 50% of bowel cancers related to lifestyle factors, which are more common in lower SES, such as smoking, alcohol excess, obesity, poor diet, a sedentary lifestyle, then lower SES are less likely to be privately insured. So that's the only way I could think that there'd be the difference, that you're more likely to find polyps in a public hospital. Otherwise, I don't understand the question.
Okay, thank you. In the future, will there be reviews of all centres to make sure they meet the guidelines, both private and public?
If by that you mean, is the clinical care standard going to be assessed? Yes, that's part of the NSQHS standards and the governance standard. And this will be looked at in every single public and private institution that provides colonoscopy. And all of those will need to meet the standards as set, or remediation will be required. And technically, if remediation doesn't allow for meeting of the standard, there could be a non-recertification of your institution. I'm not directly involved with the assessment of standards. I'm not involved with the assessors, but perhaps Anne could give you a rundown of the protocols. If you're found not to meet the standard, what remediation may be required and what the final outcome would be. Anne, do you have any other comments?
There are processes, but basically, the national standards are to ensure that only facilities that can meet the standard function. So you can stop functioning, really, if you can't meet the standards. I mean, there's obviously a halfway ground where there's remediation in there. But in answer to the question, does the colonoscopy clinical care standard? Yes, it matter. Yes, it does, as part of the accreditation of the facility. And if you fail part of the standards, you fail the standards. But I couldn't get into the detail of remediation and what's the bar for getting remediation and what's the bar for just straight out fail.
The assessors are certainly trained in how to assess the standard by the system and how they approach a single facility that does not meet that standard, I suppose, depends on how far away from the standard they are.
The standards have been around for quite a period of time, so most facilities, well, all facilities recognise that that's the framework in which they need to work. So behind the scenes, facilities are working to ensure they don't actually not make the standards. So I would suspect that the facilities you work at are busily trying to make sure that everything's in place to meet the standard around colonoscopy clinical care standard.
I'll just add to that, we did develop an assessor video. So if you go onto the Commission website, there's a video in there on the website that we developed for assessors, but it's also a useful video for clinicians to look at what it is that the colonoscopy is trying to capture, what are the, you know, the quality statements. So that's also a useful resource.
Thank you. Iain Gregor Brown is out there. His comment, good work. Is it worth mentioning with your conjoint committee hat on that we have opened the grandfather experienced practitioner pathway for practicing colleagues who are not certified to be able to have their original colonoscopy training certified to enable them to access recertification? Is it worth mentioning it? I've just mentioned it.
I think it is worth mentioning it. And as Gregor said, the experienced practitioner pathway is available. If any of you do not have currently conjoint recognition of training, you can go to the conjoint website and the pathway is detailed there for you. If there are any questions, you can contact the recertification administrative group, conjoint administrative group, and they will be able to provide further information and support for your ability to access conjoint recognition of your training. Sometimes there are some complexities, especially in rural and remote regions, where the ability to have one of your colleagues present for your colonoscopies can be somewhat limited. However, I wonder now, in the current climate of COVID and our incredible ability to utilise Zoom, whether you actually have to be in the same room. And I haven't thought about this, Gregor, but does Zoom supervision of a colonoscopy or observation of a colonoscopy count the same as sitting in the same room? So we might have to debate that at the next conjoint.
Great. Does the committee anticipate that reimbursement from Medicare and or health funds will depend on adherence or compliance with the guidelines?
If you're talking about the colonoscopy clinical care standard, that is merely the ability of your facility to continue working as an endoscopy facility, as a colonoscopy facility, based on a set of very clear standards. That's nothing to do with you or your remuneration. I think what you may be asking partly is about the item numbers and the fact that the item numbers are based on the current practice guidelines for review colonoscopy, surveillance colonoscopy, IBS review colonoscopy, colonoscopy for patients with symptoms, and how that is undertaken. And so remuneration is going to be based on, to an extent, the guidelines, because the item numbers reflect the guidelines. But this does not connect in any way with the clinical care standard for colonoscopy. And do you want to say anything more about that?
No, I think you're right. The MDS is a reimbursement system. And the private insurers, well, basically the standard is saying only certified and recertified colonoscopists will be practicing in the future. So there will not be any sort of differential payment because everybody who's doing it will be all the same. They'll all be recertified or certified and recently certified and yet to be recertified. But there won't be such a thing as a non-certified, recertified procedurist.
And you won't be able to undertake colonoscopy in a centre that doesn't meet standards. So you may not be able to practice at all because there's no centre, but it's not going to change remuneration in terms of item numbers or what you get as an individual.
Okay, how do we justify an indication based on our gut instinct For example, I had a 43-year-old lady with a thrombosed hemorrhoid whom I did a hemorrhoidectomy and then did a follow-up colonoscopy after 6 weeks, only to find a large splenic flexure cancer. She did not meet any obvious criteria for colonoscopy. Her life was saved, but it's hard to justify gut instinct always.
And again, this falls a little bit outside the care standard. This is certainly looking a lot more at indications for colonoscopy. Yes, you're right. Perhaps gut instinct led you to do this, but it is serendipity. And we know that there will be a certain proportion of people who have procedures done on rectal procedures where there's no bleeding, who won't have a colonoscopy, who could just by chance, because we know a certain percentage of the population have them, will have a big polyp or a cancer present in their colon. And yes, that was serendipitous. I've certainly had patients who've been in the same position, who've had procedures, who've been young, who haven't justified colonoscopy, and you're right, 3 years' time, they've had a cancer. But there was no reason at the time of their original procedure to actually undertake a colonoscopy. They did not meet any indications. As a medical practitioner, none of us can hope to diagnose everything perfectly and prevent every single condition. As long as you have good documentation at the time that you've seen the patient and you document that this does not justify colonoscopy based on the current understanding of what should justify colonoscopy, because that's been risk stratified, then you know, all we can do is practice to the best of our abilities. If we argued that every patient who walked through our doors should get a colonoscopy by about the 9th of September or maybe the 10th, we would be so overloaded that we'd not be able to practice anymore. There would be so many colonoscopies being done. And so there has to be some element of health economics and health rationalization in the practice of everything we do. And this includes every facet of medicine, surgery. You're not always going to get it right. And it hurts when you don't get it right. Don't think I don't know that. But the bottom line is that you practice under the guidelines of your profession. You do the best you can. You make good decisions. And yeah, if you have a gut instinct, we'll do it. There is an item number which says this is a colonoscopy which you know, has no reason, but you can use this item number once and reimburse the patient. Or if you can't use that, talk to the patient about actually paying for the colonoscopy if you still believe it's necessary. I certainly have talked to patients, and if you talk to them enough and there are problems and you have a gut feeling, it's often because they've hinted subtly that there is an indication, that there is a problem, that there is some bleeding or there is some pain. And therefore, actually, if you explore that deeply enough, there will be a reason.
Thank you. With the four indicators that need to be monitored, is there a resource available to help with capturing these?
In terms of auditing your practice, or rather the centre auditing practice, this is something that the centre needs to keep. And therefore, whether it be your hospital, whether it be your private endoscopy centre or private hospital, there needs to be some form of record keeping. Many of the software providers are trying to do this. If you don't have a software provider, then the utilisation of polyp registers in your endoscopy suite, where manual documentation or the utilisation of a database which is developed within your facility, are all tools which can be used. We at the Commission have not got a database that you can generically pick up, but I might throw to Siobhan to see if she has any other comments about potential developments in that space.
So as I said earlier, we've been working closely with Provation and Endobase because we are aware that, and they both those systems fully support the first two indicators, which are cecum intubation and bowel prep. The other two indicators around adenoma detection rate and sessile serrated adenomas, because that's waiting for histopathology results to come back from pathology, that has to be retrospectively entered into the systems currently. So they are aware of that being more of a manual process, and they're working towards how they can progress with that. And we've been working with them. In fact, I have a meeting with them tomorrow to discuss how we can support them to help with future development of their system. What we have done at the Commission is we've developed a specification for capturing our indicators, which we hope to put up on our website. And that's so if it's, if, for example, you would be able to use that if you want to build your own system, which often some facilities have, they've just built something themselves, or they've, or if it's another software system that you are familiar with and you use locally, which isn't one of the endobases or privation, that you could supply them with this specification, which basically gives them the details of how they should be capturing the indicators and then be able to report on those. So I hope that helps.
I could sort of update as well that at my hospital, my medical director governance has actually been communicating directly with the probation team about direct upload utilising specific computer language of results into probation, and some work around that space going on in the United States at the moment. So they're working towards it, they're trying to do it. And given that so many facilities have probation and they've sold it so widely, we've certainly discussed with them that they have a reasonable responsibility to be able to support the needs of those of us who use probation. I think endobase probably feel pretty much the same as well.
Yeah.
Okay. How do you approach when a patient had a colonoscopy 2 years ago, then FOBT found positive again? What is the recommendation?
Again, I think this is a question which is well outside the scope of the standard. There are, in the surveillance guidelines, statements around when FOBT should be recommenced. And in fact, you're asking me a question that I've dealt with clinically today. And so I'm reevaluating the patient by talking to them, seeing if symptoms have changed, looking at my past colonoscopy, trying to work out if there is any chance that I may have missed something. And it becomes then a decision between you and the patient as to whether you believe that that faecal occult blood should be taken notice of or not taken notice of. And this, to an extent, is a clinical decision. You know, 2 years ago, everything was normal, as far as you could tell. And so it's not beyond any of us to have missed something, and certainly it can happen. So you need to make a very good clinical decision with your patient about the risks and benefits. If you do have an uncertainty, remember that as a colonoscopist, doing colonoscopy as a normal part of your practice, you can also order CT colonography, which will give a reasonable indication of lesions within the colon. And so if you wished an alternative strategy, and look, different people will do different things, you are able to request CT colonography. It is not just for failed colonoscopy. If you are a colonoscopist who in the course of your practice feel that it would be more appropriate for a patient to have a CT colonography rather than a colonoscopy to investigate an abnormality, that is covered by the item number. So you are able to offer alternatives to the patient as well. And as a clinician, would you like to make any comment on that?
Oh, I agree with you. I mean, you've got to take a history. Did they have bleeding hemorrhoids at the time of the FOBT test, all those sorts of questions, then it's a clinical judgment. And it demonstrates the importance of having previous colonoscopy reports. And that's one of the reasons why the standard is saying make sure patients get a copy of their reports. Because if it hadn't been you 2 years ago, you'd be busily chasing, you'd either do it again automatically, or you'd be spending time chasing up where the last colonoscopy was done and getting a copy of the report. But it is, at the end of the day, a clinical decision with as much of the data that you can elicit from the patient and the records.
And again, you will not always be right. And we, as clinicians, have to accept that there are times that we will be wrong. We will try and make the best decision. And the art of what we all do is making an adequate decision, sometimes with inadequate information.
I'll just add, before we go on to the next question, there was a comment about the previous question. At our facility, we are part of a benchmarking group, and clinical indicators are collected every 6 months and submitted to ACHS. I believe this might help with the previous question.
Certainly the ACHS indicators do cover some of these, and that program, which I am aware of, has been utilised by many facilities. Again, clearly it means that your facility is documenting these things. And so that's all manual though. It has to be uploaded by somebody. Probably not going to be you as the colonoscopist, but somebody has to upload it.
And just another comment also here, Provation version 2 in USA does integrate pathology reports into the endoscopy report. I'm told it will need to integrate with EMR in Australia. Glad to hear people are working on it.
There's also a pathology reporting system which is used by the majority of the pathology providers that has a language that can be apparently integrated into this space so that direct importation is available.
That's great.
Great. There's also a comment from Nick Ding just regarding the bowelprep.net website. They'll be supplying an app for carers or patients, which will be linked to each of the clinicians' rooms and in the future consent information as part of the system. Thanks again for the mention. Happy to onboard any rooms and email address provided. I might pop that in the chat to everybody as well rather than read out an email address. So the next question, spinning of patients undergoing gastroscopy, colonoscopy is a divisive technique. Our institution has had some near misses when spinning, but certain clinicians insist on continuing to spin patients. What is the College of Anaesthetists' opinion on this topic in terms of safe delivery of colonoscopy following a gastroscopy?
Again, I think it's a little outside the remit of the Colonoscopy Clinical Care Standard, and each individual facility needs to work out what is safe or not safe within their facility. The majority of the places that I work do still turn the patient on the bed, as in the whole bed turns. I'm not sure whether you mean actually turning the bed on its wheels or getting the patient to turn themselves around to the other end of the bed. Perhaps you could clarify that, but turning the bed on its wheels has never been commented to me by the nursing staff, the anaesthetist or the techs in facilities I work at as a problem, assuming all the tubes are well looked after. Would you like to clarify what you mean by spinning the patient?
Okay, we'll give that person a chance to answer that if they're still here. Another one, when is the last date for recertification?
So recertification, again, outside the remit of this per se, but recertification should be undertaken every 3 years. There is a little bit of a leeway given COVID, and we're at the moment debating some extensions to recertification interval based on specific individual needs and time away from practice. But recertification needs to be done every 3 years. As long as your institution can demonstrate in their assessment of the standard that you are in the process of recertification and are proceeding towards it, not just logging and not submitting, then I think the assessors will be happy that everyone is complying with the spirit of the standard. If they come back a couple of years later and you're still logging and still haven't submitted and still haven't been recertified, I think they'll decide that you're not taking this seriously, and neither is your facility, and there will be ramifications. But essentially, every 3 years, recertification currently is mandated. Whether that changes over time, we don't know. But at this point in time, that is what has been set by the recertification system. Anne, would you like to say anything more about that?
Yeah, the further, I agree with exactly what you're saying, the further away we get from the launch of the standard, the less tenable it is that you haven't recertified, because, you know, there's been sort of time to do it. So people would have to be able to really demonstrate to an assessor, or the institution would have to demonstrate to the assessor that it's reasonable not to have recertified colonoscopists when they're getting certified, because it's all about the view about patient safety. So it's a question of, you know, is it reasonable, you know, 3 years after it became mandatory not to have somebody recertified? So my view would be to get on with it, because it's in your interest. It's, you're a better colonoscopist, you know where you stand, you're auditing, it's good practice.
I think one of the issues that has sort of come up is people get very concerned that they miss their deadline for recertification, and suddenly they're not recertified, and therefore their facility theoretically can stop them from practicing. And again, I think that that's probably fair if there's no reason for it, but my interpretation of both recertification and standard is that if there's a particular reason that you have not recertified, then an extension may be granted for particular reasons, and that there may be a reason that your facility still lets you practice because you, for some reason, haven't just submitted, or there's been a minor glitch, or you're in the process of being audited, as 10% of those are. And so, you know, I would not see your facility as likely to stop you practicing if there's a good reason for why you currently are not fully recertified, but it's in the offing.
Yeah, I think
if you've never bothered, then that's another kettle of fish.
I think if you've been away from practice or maternity leave or something like that, then a facility has to work out how it would ensure patient safety, recognising that you've been out of the loop and you just don't have 150 colonoscopies because you've been in recent times because you've been away. But the institution would have to provide some sort of mechanism to ensure that you're safe and you're as safe as your colleagues. But that's in those special circumstances. If you've been practicing every day and you just haven't got round to it, well, says something about your enthusiasm for being high quality and looking after patients, I suppose.
There are some people who've commented that COVID has slowed their practice and made it difficult, but remember, it doesn't have to be prospective. Yeah. You can log some of these retrospectively. So to make up your consecutive 150, if you have to go back, that's fine.
Yeah,
so long as you have them there.
Victoria certainly has a challenge that needs to be recognised.
Yeah, I think you've answered. There's a question around an extension to certification due to reduced numbers due to COVID. So I think we'll mark that question as done.
That's been documented as a 6-month extension at the moment.
Yes. Right. Just a response from the person that asked the question regarding the spinning. So spinning the bed on wheels, hence away from the anaesthetic machine, airway issues then provide higher risk when at the opposite end of the bed.
Mostly my patients, I'm on one side and the anaesthetist is on the other side. And in fact, at gastroscopy, the anaesthetist is facing the patient's back, and at colonoscopy is facing the patient's front, because the anaesthetic machine and the anaesthetic setup is placed directly in the middle of the patient's back, not at the top of the patient or the bottom of the patient, but centrally. So my anaesthetist is always very close to the patient, not at one end or the other.
Thank you. We're coming to the end of questions. Will integrated pathology results into reports eventually become standard across public and private?
I think all I can say is I hope so.
Yeah, I'd say the same.
Yeah, but I don't think we're going to mandate it as part of the standard at this point in time, but I would hope that the development of this through the companies that provide the software will mean that it just happens in every software. But again, it's like all of these things. We have aspirations, but we don't necessarily have the ability to control everything to make those happen.
Right. That's the end of the questions. There is a comment from Ian Turner, item number 32228. I think it was in regard to a question a few questions ago.
that I think is that the one-off number, which means that you can do a colonoscopy for no reason whatsoever and the patient will still be reimbursed for that.
Yep, great. That's all of our questions. Anne, just before I flick to you, I might just launch a small poll. We've still got plenty of people online just to give us some feedback on tonight and then we'll head to you, Anne.
Thank you. Okay.
Just a few short questions there on your screen. If you could please complete those. Okay, Anne, over to you. I'll let people continue doing the poll, but over to you to wrap up.
Well, thank you. Ian, as usual, a fantastically informative, clear presentation on the clinical care standards. I think everybody would agree with me that it was a very useful presentation. So on behalf of the Commission, thank you very much yet again for all the work you've done on the standards and continue to do, and for tonight's presentation, which I hope people have found very useful and help them improve quality and safety of colonoscopy in their institution. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Anne.
And thank you to the audience for joining in tonight. I know how busy everybody is. I hope you found it useful. And if there's any resources or any questions you have, then by all means, email us and we'll do our best to answer those questions. Thank you.
Certainly like to echo that. And it's been a pleasure being able to be here, and I hope that everyone's found something in this presentation that's made a difference to how they practice and how their institution can practice and meet this standard, because the standard's there for all of us as well. But when we have our colonoscopy, hopefully the standard will keep us safe in the same way that it'll keep our patients as safe and as well looked after as possible.
Yeah, absolutely. Good night all.
Good night. Thanks, everybody. Thanks for joining.